Hi, dear students. I hope you're doing well. Let's continue doing some exercises about the gaseous state, okay? One, a sample of carbon dioxide occupies 0.3 liters at 10 degrees and 750 torr. What volume will the gas have at 30 degrees and 750 torr? Okay. A sample of carbon dioxide occupies 0.3 liters at 10 degrees and 750 torr. What volume will the gas have at 30 degrees and 750 torr? So, we have to take in account, as always, the ideal gas model, PV equals to nRT, okay. So, reading the text of the exercise, we can recognize that the pressure is constant, and I can understand the moles are constant during this changing of temperature. So, what I can write regarding this equation? That I can write that if T is constant and N is constant, nRT is constant. So PV equals to constant. Oh no, the pressure is constant. Sorry. The temperature is changing. So P divided by nR equals to T divided by V equals to constant. Okay. Now it works. So I can use directly this form of the equation because I know all this term is constant. And I can write that the temperature, the initial temperature divided by the initial volume equals to the final temperature divided by the final volume. And after that, the final volume is equal to the final temperature multiplying the initial volume and divided the initial temperature. Here I can erase this one. Equals. Okay, now I have to substitute the temperature here, and in the changing the Celsius degrees with the Kelvin. So the initial temperature is equals, I can write here, initial temperature equals to 20 plus 273.15 equals to 10. Okay, 0.15 Kelvin. And this is the initial temperature, 10 degrees. And the final temperature has to be 30 degrees, okay. So I can write directly 303.15 Kelvin. So substituting here, I obtain 303.15 divided by 283.15 multiplying initial volume, that is equals to 0.3 liters. And all this term is equals to 0.32 liters. Okay. Perfect. So the increasing of the temperature brings an increasing of the volume. Okay. Two. Calculate the density, in gram per liters of the methane of of the ammonia NH3 and of hydrogen at 50 degrees and 3 atmospheres. Okay. Perfect. As always, we use the ideal model gas, PV equals to nRT. So, to obtain something that consider the density of the gaseous species we are considering, I can work on the equation in this way. I can collect properly all the terms of the equation in this way, equals to P divided RT. So, here we have mole divided by volume. And in practice, a molar concentration of the gas in which V is the real volume of the gas. But if I multiply V both the members of the equation by the molar mass of the gas, I can obtain that. Here we have the molar mass multiplying the moles, and so the mass in grams. The mass divided by the volume is equal to the molar mass of the gas multiplying P divided by RT. And after, here I can recognize the density I'm searching for, the mass divided by the volume. And so I can write rho. The Greek letters always used to indicate the or usually used to indicate the density equals to the molar mass multiplying the pressure divided by RT. Perfect. And this is the equation I can use to calculate what the text is asking me. It's interesting considering that if the equation from which we start is a general and generic representation of the behavior of the gaseous species without referring to any kind of gas in particular. This works for every kind of gas. In the working in this way on the equation, we can introduce in the equation, in the same equation, something related to a specific gas by the molar mass. So here regarding the methane, I can write that the molar mass of the methane is equal to 12.01 plus 4.04, and so 16.05 gram per mole. And so, I can consider directly the temperature. Temperature is equal to the 50 degrees plus 273.15 equals to 323.5 Kelvin. Okay, the pressure in atmosphere goes well in this without any changing. So now I can write that rho methane, rho is rho, is equal to 16.05 multiplying the pressure 3 divided by the universal constant of the gas in this case 0.0821, because the unit of measurements I'm using, and multiplying the temperature, 3 to 3.5 equals to, maybe I did this calculation, I hope. No, I have to do it, it's not a problem. Can do it very fast. 3 divided by 0.0821 equals divided by 3 to divided by 3 to 3.15. Multiplying 16.05. Maybe I did something wrong. 3 divided 0.0821 equals divided 3. Okay. Multiplying 17.05. Okay. 1.81 gram per liters. So you can do the same thing. Or here I write the water. Okay. Rho of the ammonia equals 2. Here I can erase the calculation. I want to leave this one. Here I can write the ammonia and H3. Ammonia has a molar mass 14.01 plus 3.03 by the hydrogen. So 17.04 gram per mole. So here I can write 17.04 multiplying 3 divided by 0.0821 multiplying 3 to 3.15 equals 2. 3 divided 0.0. Okay. Divided. All this term is equals to 0. Okay, I can remember for the next calculation. Okay, multiplying 17.04, I obtain 1.93 gram per liter. And finally, the hydrogen rho H2 equals 2. The molar mass of the hydrogen is equals to 0.02. Multiplying 3 divided by 0.0821, multiplying 3 to 3.15 equals 2. 0.113 multiplying 2.02. Okay. As expected, is the smaller. The density of the hydrogen is the smaller. 0.23 gram per mole.
Yes.
Okay. We can go on. 3. 1.01 grams of hydrogen, 0.28 grams of carbon monoxide, and 1.40 grams of nitrogen are introduced into a 27.40 liters container at 25 degrees. Calculate the partial pressure and volumetric and volumetric percentage of each gas okay. Perfect. Here we have a mixture, a gaseous mixture of these three gases. And the exercise is asking us the partial pressure of each of these gas and the volumetric percentage. Okay, we will see. Here we can use the Dalton's law. We can ask help to Dalton's law to solve this exercise, because we can solve it using also using the ideal gas model, but and we will do it. But we can use together the Dalton's law, because the Dalton's law says us that the partial pressure in a mixture, in a gaseous mixture, composed by n different gases together without reacting one to each other, the partial pressure of the I generic gas of the mixtures is equals to the product between the mole fraction of that gas, of this gas, multiplying the total pressure of the mixer. And in this case, this formula is very useful for us. So, using it, I have to calculate the mole fraction of each of the gas. Okay, so for the first, I evaluate the moles of each gases, writing that the moles of the hydrogen, the gaseous hydrogen, are equals to equals to 1.01, the mass of the hydrogen, divided by the molar mass of the hydrogen, 2.02. This is equals to 0.5 moles, of course. After the moles of monoxide, equals to 0.28 divided by the molar mass of the carbon monoxide molar mass that is equals to 12.01 plus 16, and that gives 20.01 equals to 0.01 moles. Finally, the moles of nitrogen equals to 1.40, that is the mass divided by the molar mass of the nitrogen, that is 14.01 multiplying 2, so 28.01 equals to 0.05 moles. Now, we can calculate, knowing that the mole fraction, of any gases. So it's better to slightly move. Okay. So I can write XH2 equals to moles of H2 divided by the total moles of the mixtures plus moles of carbon monoxide plus the moles of the nitrogen equals to 0.5 divided in practice 0.5 plus 0.01 plus 0.05, so the result is 0.56. These are the total moles of the mixtures, and this fraction is equals to, I have to do the calculation. Unfortunately, I have to do the calculation. 0.5 divided by 0.56 equals to 0.89 without any units of measurements, of course, because mole and moles are simplified one each other. Okay, in the same way, X of monoxide equals to 0.01 divided by 0.56, and the result is 0.01 divided by 0.56, 0.02, and finally X of nitrogen equals to 0.05 divided 0.56 equals to
0.05 divided by 0.56 equals to 0.0, I have to put 8 to adjust.
sum of the mole fraction has to give 1. Final step is the calculation of the total pressure of the mixtures. Total pressure of the mixtures, considering that the total moles of the mixtures are equals, the total moles of the mixture are equals to 0.5. As we already calculate, the total pressure of the mixtures is equal to total moles multiplying RT divided by the volume, equals to 0.56 multiplying 0.0821 multiplying temperature is has to be equals to 25 degrees. So we are considering 298.5 Kelvin divided by 27.40 liters equals to, I did this calculation, 4.95 atmosphere. So I can go back raising here. So I want to shift the board, and finally I can write that the partial pressure of hydrogen equals to the mole fraction of the hydrogen multiplying total pressure equals to 0.89 multiplying 4.95 equals to 4.41 atmospheres. Same way, PCO equals to XCO multiplying total pressure equals to 0.02 multiplying 4.95 equals to 0.1 atmosphere, and the last the partial pressure of the nitrogen, X nitrogen multiplying total pressure equals to 0.09 equals to, here, now I can erase. Equals to 0.44 atmosphere. 4.5. 4.4.
It's the right approximation. So, if I do 4.41 plus 0.1 plus 0.44, I obtain 4.95. Okay, and this is, these are the principal statement by Dalton's regarding the partial pressure. The sum of the partial pressure are equals to the total pressure of the mixer. And it works. Okay. Exercise 4. Mixture. Oh, I forget to calculate the volumetric. Oh yes, volumetric percentage. Okay, I forget to do this part of the exercise. It's not a problem. I will give you the possibility to do it by yourself, considering that in practice we just have this kind of percentages, because we have calculated the mole fraction of the three gases, and this calculation is useful also to calculate the volumetric percentages, because if we consider the Avogadro law, Avogadro says us that the ratio between the moles and the volume is equal to constant if P and T are constant. So, considering this condition, if we imagine that P and T are constant, and we consider two generic different thermodynamic states that we can indicate with the 1 and 2, for example, we can write that N1 divided by V1 equals to N2 divided by V2. But this means that N1 divided by N2 equals to V1 divided by V2. So what we have obtained? We have obtained that the mole fraction of the gases are equals to the volume fraction of the gases. And so, when we calculate the X of any gas, we in practice obtain the fraction not also in moles, but not only in moles, but also in volume. So, to obtain the percentage of the hydrogen in terms of volume, we only have to multiply the mole fraction of the space by 100.
And what we obtain is the percentage in volume of this gas. So you have to do three passages in this way to obtain the number required by the text of the exercise. Sorry, I forget to do this part, but I think I recover. Okay. So, four. A mixture of gases has the following composition. Sulfur dioxide, 40%. Nitrogen, 20%. Oxygen equals to 30%. And finally, water equals, 10%. Okay, calculate the composition percentages. No, the composition percentages by way a mixture of gases has the following composition. Calculate by volume, calculate the composition by weight. Okay, perfect. Here we can continue to use the Avogadro law because inverted to the regards of the previous exercise, because here we start from composition by volume, and we can consider that this composition by volume are equals to the composition by moles of the mixture. So these percentages are as the same value if considered by moles. So I can write that I consider 100 moles of the mixture so I directly write that moles of sulfur dioxide are equals to 100 multiplying 40% equals to 40 mole. With the same reasoning, the mole of nitrogen are equals to 20 mole. The mole of oxygen are equals to 30 moles. And finally, the mole of the water are equals to 10 mole. Good. Now, can shift a little. Okay. Considering the sulfur dioxide, what we have to calculate? We have to calculate the percentage of the sulfur dioxide considered by weight. Okay? And this is equal to the mass of the sulfur dioxide divided by the total mass of the mixture multiplied by 100. This is what we have to calculate. But I can work on this relation, trying to develop it. So, for example, the mass of the sulfur dioxide could be written as the product by the molar mass of the sulfur dioxide multiplying the moles of the sulfur dioxide divided by the total mass is the sum of the three masses. So, I can write divided by the molar mass of the sulfur dioxide multiplying by the moles plus the molar mass. I can read here. The molar mass of the nitrogen multiplying the moles of the nitrogen plus the molar mass of the oxygen multiplying the moles of the oxygen finally plus the molar mass of water multiplying the moles of water. Okay. So in this way, I have already obtained what I need. So I can substitute. The molar mass of the sulfur dioxide, I have to calculate it. Molar mass of the sulfur dioxide, right here. Equals to 32.065 plus 64.065 grams per mole. Molar mass of the nitrogen. Well, this is well known. Okay, I can continue here. So I can write. Multiplying 40 plus 28.02 multiplying 20 plus 32 multiplying
30 plus 18.02 multiplying the 10 equals 64.065 multiplying 40. So in this case, we obtain 2,562.6 divided by 18.02 multiplying 10 it seems the result is 4,263.2 equals 62.6 Okay, I obtain 0.6. So, following the same way, I can calculate the other percentages. Here, there's always has to be multiplied by 100, of course. I leave it equals to 60%. Okay, for the other compound, percentages of nitrogen equals to the mass of the nitrogen it is 28.02 multiplying 20 divided by 4,263.2 Okay, equals to 0.13 multiplying 100 equals to 13%.
And then percentages, the percentage of oxygen equals to 32 multiplying 30 divided by 4263.2 equals to 22.5%, and finally, what? Water percentage of water equals to 12.02 multiplying 10 divided by the same number per 100. So we obtain 4.2%. Now we can check the approximation we have used to did this calculation by the sum of the four percentages. Here we have 22.5 plus 4.2 plus 13 plus 12. Well, I used a very rough approximation, but the calculation could be more precise considering the numbers after the point in the for the various percentage we have considered. But in this it's a rough approximation, but it's not a problem. It's only a question to consider more precise numbers between the calculations. Okay, I think it's 5. How many liters of CO2 in standard condition standard condition are produced. By the complete. Combustion. Of 150 grams of butane gas C4H10 interrogative. Okay, only this. Perfect. So here a useful calculation for some technical application. We would like to know how many liters of carbon dioxide are produced when we totally burn a kind of combustible, in this case the butane. And so the first thing I have to do is to write the reaction or combustion of the butane. C4H10 plus oxygen equals to 4 molecules of carbon dioxide plus 5 molecules of water. And after the oxygen is 8 plus 15, 13. Yes. 13 halved. So, 13 halved. So, I can multiply both the members by 2, obtaining that. Eight, and here, 10. Let's check. 16 atoms of oxygen plus 10, 26, and here 26. 8 atoms of carbon, 8 atoms of carbon, and 20 atoms of hydrogen, 20 atoms of hydrogen. Okay, it works. So now we have mass of the hydrocarbon equals to 150 grams. And so the moles of the hydrocarbon are equals to 150 divided by 58.14 gram per mole, and so the result is 2.58 moles. Okay, but we want to know how much carbon dioxide is produced, and so I can write the stoichiometric ratio between the unknown term, the carbon dioxide, and the known term, the hydrocarbon, equals to 8 divided by 2, in practice 4. So I'm doing a battle with the wire. Okay, moles of CO2 equals to 4 multiplying the moles of, okay? And so in this case, we obtain 4 multiplying 2.58 equals to 14. Okay. This number is correct. And after, multiplied by 4, I obtain 10.32 moles of carbon dioxide. So, now we can calculate how many liters in the standard condition are produced. I'd like to recall that the standard condition, okay, standard condition are defined by the pressure at 1 atmosphere and the temperature equals to 298.15 Kelvin. In practice, 25 Celsius degrees. And so, here I can write that the volume of the CO2 produced are equals to the moles of the CO2 multiplying RT divided by P equals to 10.32 multiplying 0.0821 multiplying 298.15 divided by 1. And we obtain 8.74 liters in standard condition. I want to check. Okay, something goes wrong. It seemed to me too small. Okay, now the calculator did correctly its work. 252.6 liters. Okay, now it seems more justifiable. Okay. doing now. Ah, okay. Now I would like to change arguments. And now I would like to do some exercises regarding the equilibria, the chemical equilibria. And so, move on. Cannot remember the number, maybe six. Right. The expression for the reaction for the reaction quotient for each of the following reactions. Okay. A gas B gas plus gas three CO two gas plus 4H2O gas last also water. Yes. Okay. And yes. I'm checking for the indication relative to the the aggregation state of the substances participating in this equilibria, because it is very important to consider this question. When we are called to write the reaction quotient of an equilibrium, we have to consider the aggregation for first the aggregation state of the compounds comparing in the reactions, and so understanding if as in this case here we have all homogeneous equilibrium in which all the compounds are in the gaseous states. So this means that when I write the reaction quotient, I have to introduce in it all the species appearing in the reaction. Why? Because here we have all gases, as I said, and the gases at constant temperature can be compressible, can be compressible, so they can change their concentration and their density also at constant temperature. And this fact makes possible that the gases has influence on equilibria. The substances that are able to have influence and to lead an equilibrium are the substances that are able to change their concentration. And a solid, for example, put together with the gas are not able to, and giving rise to some equilibrium reaction, of course, are not able, the solid are not able to define it and to have influence on the equilibrium because the solid doesn't change their concentration or their density at constant temperature. We consider the solid theoretically uncompressible. This characteristic define that the solid matter is not able to lead some reaction of equilibrium in the presence of the gas. Are the gas that are able to define the changing of an equilibrium state to another equilibrium state. But we will see after an example of heterogeneous equilibria, and it will be more clear. Here we have all gases, all the species are in the same state of aggregation, so we have to consider all in the reaction quotient. Reaction quotient, I would like to remind you, is a particular parameter that is the mathematical statement in practice of the law of the action mass and of the mass action, and it can be written in this way. If we consider a generic situation of equilibrium, writing in this way, the most generic as possible, E, D. Okay. Here, the A, B, C, D, big, are could be any kind of formula of a compound, okay? And A, B, C, D, lowercase letter, are the stoichiometric coefficients to the respect of the compound the we are considering. So, for example, could be CH4 and something else. Okay, the reaction quotient is defined as the ratio in which I write the concentration, the product of the concentration of the species appearing in the second segment on the left, on the right side of the equation that are elevated to the respective stoichiometric coefficient divided by the product of the concentration, of the molar concentration of the reactants, reading the reaction from left to right, elevated to the respective stoichiometric coefficient. Okay. This kind of a writing with brackets, it's only another symbol to indicate a molar concentration of the space. So, in practice, for example, the concentration of C here is equal to the moles of C divided by the volume. So we are talking about moles per liters. Okay? It's only another way to write a classical molar concentration. Moles divided by the volume, the total volume. And so, starting from these from this equation, we can put in practice what I wrote here for a general equilibrium. So it's more difficult to see entirely the reaction. Okay, for this first case, Q is equal to the concentration of this nitrogen oxide elevated to 4, multiplying the concentration of O2 divided by concentration of N2O5 elevated to 2. So it's very simple defining. I remember you that I would like to recall you that the reaction quotient is the parameter that during the reaction is taking place change second per second, But when the equilibrium condition are reached, the Q stops to change, and it becomes equals to a so-called constant equilibrium that we indicate with K or KC, equilibrium constant to the respect of the concentration. And in practice, this is a parameter characteristic of the system that doesn't change that it's constant if we don't change the temperature of the system. So we can use this value referred to the equilibrium condition, which here we have concentration of equilibrium. In the case Q becomes equals to Kc, and we can use so the value of this constant to do calculation about the quantities of the spaces that are in equilibrium and in a condition which the reaction doesn't go to completion, are not complete, and a part of the reactants remains at the end of the process, the equilibrium condition, of course, and some quantities of product are in equilibrium with the remaining part of the reactants. This by two reactions that occurring together simultaneously at the same speed, at the same velocity. Okay, and for the second equilibrium, I can write, it's better to, for me to write, to read here, I can write Q equals to concentration of CO2 elevated to 3, multiplying concentration the H2O elevated to 4, divided by the concentration of C3H. Elevated to 1. Okay. Elevated to. I have read the wrong. Oh, I have read the wrong. The wrong lines. Oh, the first denominator is correct. Oh, no, no, no. I have read the right lines. Okay. Perfect. So we put in the numerator the products, and in the denominator the what we call reactants, because they are on the left side. But we have to consider that the reactions are occurring together in both the direction, and so what we call reactants are in the same time products for the indirect reactions that is taking place. So last here Q equals to. Here I have considered this one, okay. Concentration of H of NO Q equals to concentration of NO to 4 multiplying concentration H2O to 7 and to 6. Divided by the concentration of the ammonia elevated to 4 and the concentration of the oxygen to 5. Okay. It's only a question to remember this form and after write the Q of any kind of equilibrium, it's very simple. Okay. Now I would like to show you two examples of heterogeneous equilibria. Okay, so you can write D, for example, calcium carbonate solid in equilibrium with calcium oxide solid and carbon dioxide gas. Okay, here we have the condition to which I'm referring before. Here we have two solids in equilibrium with a gas. In this case, we have to consider that it's only the gas that is able to give rise to this equilibrium, because the solids hasn't a possibility of movement, and this is a fact, but they cannot change their density if the temperature is constant. They are not compressible, so they cannot change their concentration, and so they are not capable to give rise in equilibrium, and to give rise in this condition, of course, to change the condition of the equilibrium. In practice, here we have a container, a closed container, that is one of the condition to have an equilibrium. The first condition is that the reaction could be reversible, and the second, that the reaction is occurring inside a container. In this case, we can consider that the temperature is about this equilibrium occurs at about 850 degrees or 900 degrees. It's not important, but here we have a certain quantity of a solid, the carbonate, and a certain quantity on the bottom of the container of the other solid that is separating from the first one, that is the calcium oxide, and then free in the entire volume the CO2. So, will be the movement of the CO2 inside the volume to give rise to the reactions, because the solids are not able to evolve one to each other, to move one to each other, to change their density. Differently, the density of the CO2 inside the volume could change enormously. And so we have to consider that only the CO2 is the species that is capable to give rise to the equilibrium. And so, considering this, every time we have some solid or some liquid together to a gas space, we have to avoid to consider the solid and the liquid from the calculation of the reaction quotient, and so for the calculation of the constant of equilibrium. In this case, Q, I have to write Q equals to the concentration of CO2 and stop. I don't have to consider this oxide, and I don't have to consider this other solid. So in this case, we have only this gaseous space compound to consider for the calculation of Q. In practice, when the condition of equilibrium are reached, Kc, it's equal to the equilibrium concentration of the CO2. Another case. Here we have a nickel oxide solid reacting with gaseous hydrogen, giving rise to nickel solid, nickel, metallic nickel, plus gaseous water. Okay? This is another reaction that occurs at middle-high temperature. So the water is gas. In this case, if I want to apply what I have said regarding the concomitants of a gas with the solid, here Q is equal to, between the products, I have to consider only the water. And between the reactants, I have to consider only the hydrogen. The two solids are not capable to give influence to the equilibrium condition. Okay. Okay, we will start with a very simple exercise. During the ammonia synthesis, reaction, the equilibrium is established. Established. Two gas plus 3H2 gas in equilibrium with two molecules of ammonia gas at a certain temperature. The mixture of the three reactants gases in closed container. With a volume of 15 liters. Is made up of 10 moles of NH3, 10 moles of nitrogen, and 30 moles of hydrogen. Calculate the Kc. So, as I said, this exercise has a text very, very long, but the exercise is very simple because it consists of only of the writing of the reaction quotient, in this case directly of the equilibrium constant, because the exercise gives us the concentration of the species at equilibrium, and so we have only to substitute to insert this the value of the concentration inside the Kc written to the respect of this equilibrium. So I can here write that it's better to write in another page. I can write that the Kc regarding this equilibrium is equal to all the species are gaseous, so it's an homogeneous equilibrium. All the species has to be considered inside the K, the equilibrium constant. And so here we have ammonia elevated to 2 divided by the concentration of the of the hydrogen, multiplying the molar concentration of the hydrogen elevated to 3. Okay. So now we calculate these three different concentration. For first, can calculate concentration of nitrogen equals to, here we have in this volume, okay, the volume, the total volume is 50 liters, and okay, and nitrogen, it is composed by 10 moles. So if we have here, we have, okay, I can check here, okay, this is equal to 0.2. This symbol stands for is sometimes used to indicate the molar concentration instead the writing mole on volume. I can write also and a big M to indicate that this is a molar concentration. Okay, after we have 10 moles of ammonia equals to, also in this case, 0.2 molar, and then the concentration of hydrogen equals to 30 moles divided by 50 liters equals to 0.6 molar. Substituting, we obtain 0.2 elevated to 2 multiplied divided by 0.2, it's multiplying 0.6 elevated to 3. Doing this calculation, we obtain that the Kc is equal to 0.9263. We obtain a little value, not so little, but not so big. The value of the T says us if the equilibrium is more shifted on the product or more shifted to the verse of the reactants. If we have for an equilibrium a Kc very, very big, we can understand that the most of the reactants are disappeared in the system, and the equilibrium is very shifted with a great production of the product. A very simple calculation. Okay. Calculate the reaction quotient and determine the direction in which the following reaction proceed. The following reaction will proceed. To reach equilibrium. Okay. Here we have the reaction 2NO gas plus Cl2 gas in equilibrium with 2NOC NaCl. Nitrosyl chloride. Okay. Yes. With KC equals to 4.6 multiplying 10 to 4. 10 to 4. Okay. And the concentration here we have a flask of 1 liter containing 0.05 mole of monoxide gas, 0.0155 mole of chlorine, and finally 0.5 mole of NOCl gas. Okay. In practice, here we have to decide what is the direction to which the equilibrium will the reaction will reach the equilibrium. If we have to decide if from the initial condition that we know by this concentration, if the equilibrium will reach following the direct reaction or the indirect reaction, the reverse reaction. And we can decide comparing, we can decide this thing comparing the Q in the known condition, in the initial condition of, I can say, with the Kc of the equilibrium. So I can write the Q equals to the concentration of this nitrosyl chlorine, NOCl, elevated by 2, divided by the concentration of the nitrogen monoxide, elevated to 2, multiplying the concentration of the chlorine, the molecular chlorine. Okay, here we have a flask of 1 liter. So, in practice, if I calculate the molar concentration, this molar concentration has the same value of the moles, because for example, for the monoxide, I have to do 0.0 moles divided by 1 liter. So we can directly write this number inside the equation. So in the case of the nitrosyl chlorine, okay, 0.5 moles. I have 0.5 moles, so 0.5 moles per liters. So 0.522 divided by the case of the monoxide, 0.0 0.05 elevated to 2. And 0.0155 of the chlorine. Okay. Equals to, I don't think I did this calculation. I have to do it. Okay. So I can write 0.5. Right, is 0.25 divided by 0.05, 0.0025 multiplying 0.0155. Okay. Perfect. So 0.25 divided by 0.0155 closed. I have obtained 6,452. So I can recognize that the Q is smaller than the KC. What does it mean? Why the reaction quotient in this situation is smaller than the Kc? Is smaller because the numerator is too low, and in the same time the denominator is too much. So what could happen to the system during the reaching of the equilibrium? The system has to react with the direct reaction, that is the reaction capable to increase the quantity of the numerator of the Q, and contextually decrease the quantities of the reactants in the left side of the reaction. So I can reply to the question of the text, saying that the equilibrium will be shifts on the right the direct reaction will be activated, and the equilibrium will be reached shifting on the right. The system evolves from left to right. Okay. maybe 9. Sorry. In the reaction, H2 plus H2 gas plus E2 gas. Producing this iodatic acid gas, we have Kc equals to 68.4 at 360 degrees. Calculate the equilibrium concentration of the species when introducing moles of H2, 1 mole of Ai2, and 1 mole of Hi into a 1,000 cubic centimeter reactor. Okay. Okay, okay. So, we have to consider this equilibrium, and we have the initial condition, the presence of all the compounds participating in the reaction. So, the first thing we have to decide what is the direction to which the system will reach the equilibrium condition. Okay. First of all, the volume of the system is 1,000 cubic centimeters. So, in practice, we have a volume equals of 1 liter. So, the initial concentrations of the three substances are, here I put E stands for initial, equals to 0.5 moles per liter. After concentration of the iodide is 1 mole per liter, and finally concentration of the acid iodatic acid equals to 1 mole per liters. So by writing this, I can calculate the reaction quotient, the initial reaction quotient, the reaction quotient calculate to respect of the initial concentration of the species present in the system of reaction. And here we can write Q equals to the concentration of the acid elevated to 2 divided by the product of the concentration. Okay, these are all initial concentration equals to 1 divided by H2, 0.5, it's multiplying 1. In practice, we obtain 1 divided 0.52. So, we obtain that. We have obtained that the Q is largely smaller than the Kc. So, what we can say that? We can say that the system, the Kc is equal to 68.4. The system has to evolve from the left to the right, producing the acid, and to reach the equilibrium until the condition, until the concentration of the species reaches the value of equilibrium, and contextually Q becomes equals to Kc. So Q has to increase monotonically until the value of Kc. Now, what I can do to calculate the final concentration, the equilibrium concentration of the species inside this, here I can write, I can erase this one. It is not useful more. Okay, to do this kind of calculation, we need to consider. I suggest you to consider. It's not the only the only procedure you can use to arrive to the final result. But I suggest you to use a reaction table. A reaction table is a table in which we can put the C stands for concentration, so I it is clear that I'm writing something relating to the concentrations. In this table, I have to write all the species that are able that has influence in the equilibrium conditions, and so. Here, all the species that are, because they are all gaseous, so I can write H2, E2, and HI. Okay. In practice, this table is a way to monitoring the principal point. On which the equilibrium, the reaching of the equilibrium is characterized. So we consider an initial condition, so an initial point of checking, a checking point related to the very initial condition in the system. Then we have to consider a variation After you will see what is variation. And then the equilibrium. The equilibrium condition. So three lines to consider. Okay. Inside the table, we can put all the concentration that are known. In this case, we know all the concentrations related to the initial conditions. So here I can write 4H2, 0.5 molar. Here, 1 molar and 1 molar. Okay. Then, to define the variation, I have to see my reaction. And considering the stoichiometric coefficients contained in the reaction, I understood that the reaction has to move from left to right. And so I can tell that the acid is produced in the reaching of the equilibrium condition. And so these two elements are decreasing. So I can tell that a quantity, an unknown quantity, minus X will be moved to react, actually, to give rise to the acid. A part, this is the part of the hydrogen that goes, that undergoes the reaction to give rise to the acid molecules. And the same part will be for of the iodide. And why? Because here we have one as stoichiometric coefficients, and here we have one in the same time. Usually we don't write one, but it's only to let me more clear. So if in the case, okay, we can see directly here what happens. So minus x, a quantity, an unknown quantity, a still unknown quantity. And to the respect of the acid, what happens? That here the coefficient is 2, so I can write that if a quantity minus x is reacting between these two elements, a quantity, contextually a quantity of the plus 2x is forming of the acid, because the coefficient here is 2. So I can write plus 2, because it's forming. What I have to write in the last lines, simply the algebraic sum of the first two lines. The equilibrium concentration of the hydrogen will be 0.5 minus x of the unite 1 minus x, and for the acid 1.2 1 plus 2x. Okay. Now we can go back to consider the form of the Kc related to this equilibrium. We have written previously the same form of 4q. Now we can speak directly of Kc, writing this is the equilibrium concentration of the iodetic acid. And then hydrogen and iodide. E2. Okay. These are equilibrium. These are equilibrium. But using this table, I found these concentrations of equilibrium to the respect of this x that is still unknown. But I can substitute inside this equation, obtaining that one plus 2x elevated to 2 is divided by 0.5 minus x multiplying 1 minus x equals 2 to what? 2, the well-known Kc given by the text of the exercise. 68.4. So, in practice, we found in the condition to make explicit the x, and so we could know exactly what are the equilibrium concentration of these three spaces. This calculation has to be conducted in this way. We have to develop this product and this quadratic calculation. So I can write one plus 4x to 2 plus the double product 4x equals, where is the equals to 68.4 multiplying I'm trying to make order in this equation to obtain a second grade equation that has to be solved, and so I want to develop this product with the distribution properties of the product. 0.5 minus 0.5x minus x plus x to 2. And so we can write 1 plus the first member still the same. Here I can do another time the distribution of the product and obtaining 34.2 minus 34.2x minus 68.4x plus 68.4x quadratic x. Okay. Now I can collect in the correct ways these terms. So I can bring this one in this second term, obtaining that 64.4 x quadratic x plus, here I have to do with the calculator. Okay, so here we have 1 that becomes minus,
so plus 4.
I think has to be 106.6x. Okay, and finally we have only these two numbers, this one and this one, it seems to me. Yes, of course. So this divide becomes minus 1, so plus 33.2 equals to 0. Now we can solve this second grade equation by the classic procedure, equals to minus b, so minus b plus minus radical here minus 4 2
Okay, positive, divided by 2, multiplying a.
Equals. Try to do this calculation. Okay. If I did correct, here I should have 53.02 divided by
2. One solution is 0.4242. The second is second solution is 1.24. Okay.
So, as you could imagine, only one of these two results are the right one. The other one is absurd. Why is absurd? How can I recognize the absurd solution? I can see that this is absurd because if I have to, if I put this that number 1.24 here, substituting the x, I obtain a negative concentration, and this is not possible. So, and also here. So in this case, I immediately understand that this could not be the correct solution for this problem. The correct solution will be this one, 0.42. And this solution, I can calculate finally the concentration of the species at equilibrium. So, okay, perfect. Concentration of hydrogen at equilibrium is, I forget it, is 0.5 minus x. 0.5 minus x. 0.5 minus 0.42 equals to 0.08 moles liters. The concentration of the iodine is 1 minus x, 1 minus 0.42 equals to 0.58 moles liters. And finally, concentration of the iodatic acid is 1 plus 2x 0.84 equals to 1.84 moles per liters. So, this way we have obtained the concentration of the equilibrium, the equilibrium concentrations. Okay. I take opportunity of this moment to say to you that I will give you many others exercises of this type that are very long to do in class, but I will give you a lot of more performed exercises so you can practice and. You could arrive to the exam in the right conditions, okay? And I would like to say you that if you will have issues, problems, uncertainty, some other things like this, don't be worried. Write me an email. I will reply the faster I can, as soon as possible, and we will solve together all the problems. And so, please use this opportunity. Okay, it is here. Perfect. Okay. Okay. Now I would like to do some exercises regarding the calculation of the pH and what we did regarding the equilibrium will come back useful also for the pH calculation. I don't remember the number, but I think 10 or 11, I don't know. Water, exposed to air, contains carbonic acid due to the reaction between carbon dioxide and water. Okay. Air saturated water has hydronium concentration caused by the dissolved CO2 of 2 multiplying 10 elevated minus 6 at 25 degrees, about 20 times larger than the pure water. Calculate the pH of the solution. At 25 Celsius degrees. Okay. I wanted to write a so long text, despite the exercise, it is very, very simple and fast to be solved, because I would like to leave you something more written to this argument. For example, here we can see a very common reaction between an oxide of a known metal with the water that give rise to an acid. This is this is a reaction that occurs every day, every second in the on the Earth, and so it's very important. The oxide of the non-metals has acidic properties because they give rise to acids when they react with water, and this is one important fact. In this case, the carbon dioxide dissolved in the water give rise to the carbonic acid, the acid that makes the water able to dissolve minerals, for example. Okay. Larger than the calculate the pH of the solution. Here the calculation of the pH is very, very simple. I remind you that the pH it's only a particular measurement of concentration of the hydronium ions inside the water. The hydronium ions inside the water are the H3O plus. Please go back to see the lesson of Professor Pansini regarding the origin of these ions. That will be clear doing exercises, but please go back to listen to the lesson of Professor Pansini. And okay, so we have to check the concentration of these ions, that are the ions that defines the acidic properties of the water of a generical solution. So the pH is defined as to be equals to minus logarithm of in 10 base of the molar concentration of the hydronium ions. Moles divided by volume. So in this case, this simple calculation consists only in substituting this concentration but the unit of measurements, I forget. I forget to write here, but here these are, of course, moles, liter, at 25 degrees. Okay, I forget the unit of measurement. In any case, we have to put this number inside the logarithm, obtaining 2 multiplying 10 elevated to minus 6 equals to 5.7. Okay, what we can derive from this result? We can derive that the solution is acid due to the action of the carbon dioxide. Is acid because the value of the pH is lower than 7, that corresponds to a neutral solution, or could correspond to a pure water or a neutral solution, the value of 7. So, okay. We can go to do something more articulated. Calculate. Maybe 12. Calculate the pH of the following aqueous solutions . So the first, a solution to multiplying 10 to minus 2 molar of the hydrochloric acid, and then I have to consider 10 minus 2 molar of sodium hydroxide. Okay. This exercise permits to expose different important things regarding the exercises related to the pH, regarding the solving of the acids, of the acid of the base, and the base in the water. Here we have hydrochloric acid. The hydrochloric acid is a strong acid, a strong electrolyte. That means that all the quantities of the acid until the water solubility limit of the acid, all the substance dissolved give rise to an ionic dissociation. And this ionic dissociation, in the interpretation of Brosted and Lowry, could be written in this way. One, I consider the acid plus the water equals to the hydronium cation plus the anion parts deriving from the acid, what I can call by the Brosted-Lowry theory the conjugate base of this acid. In practice, the acid is able to give an H plus to the water that acts like a base, and so giving rise to the hydronium cation, that is the space to which depends the acidity, the acidic properties of the solution, and so also the pH. And then we have the anionic part of the acid, free to move inside the solution. Here we don't have a double, the double arrow. Here we have a complete reaction. So all the acid that is a strong electrolyte give rise to an ionic dissociation. You can tell it to yourself, you can ask to yourself, how can I recognize if an acid is strong or weak? You can recognize this thing by remembering that the most of the acids are weak in practice. But there are some other indication to give, but the first indication for me is to take a look to the text of the exercise. If in the text of the exercise made by me, of course, there aren't equilibrium constant or some indication of some other indication like dissociation grades or something else, you can stay, you can rest sure that you are considering some kind of strong acid. As in this case, here we don't have any reference to KC or alpha, that is the dissociation grade that we will see after. And so, but you can start same time to remember that chlorhydric acid is a strong acid. Like all the halogenidric acids, excepted the hydrofluoric acid. Hydrofluoric acid is a weak acid. Hydrochloric acid, it's a strong acid. Iodidic acid is strong acid. Bromhydric acid is a strong acid. Together with this three binary acids that are strong, you can put some other ternary acid containing oxygen, like nitric acid that is strong, or sulfuric acid that is strong, and many and a few number of other atom of other acids. The most of the acids are weak. Okay, so the fact that the reaction is complete involves that the moles of the hydronium cation has to be equal to or better. We can say before that the concentration of the hydronium cation has to be equal to the concentration, to the nominal concentration of the acid. Every moles of acid brings in solution 1 mole of hydronium. And so we can write this thing. In practice, here, concentration of hydronium equals to 2, you can write directly without using the engineering notation, not so useful in this case, molar. And so the pH is equal to minus logarithm of 2.2, 0.02 equals 2. So we are considering a very acidic solution, but it is not a surprise because hydrochloric acid is a strong acid, so its content of hydrogen is given to the solution, and so we can obtain very acidic conditions. The second compound we are considering, it's a base, it's a classical base of Arrhenius, and when I dissolve a base of this hydroxide, or when I dissolve a salt, I don't need to put the water between the reactants, because this dissolving are different. In this case, when I dissolve an acid, the water, it is not only a solvent, it is a real reactant. But in this case, the water, it's only a solvent, and don't give rise to some chemical reaction like the acids do with water. So I can write the water here on the arrow only to indicate that this dissociation occurs in water. We obtain, in this case, an A plus the hydroxide ions, anions. So, for the reason, considering that all the hydroxide that are soluble, made by starting from the alkali and alkali earth metal, like sodium, potassium, lithium, calcium, magnesium, magnesium, barium, strontium, and so on, are all strong electrolytes if soluble. In this case, it's this condition is defined, is respected, and so I can write with the same reasoning adopted here that the concentration of the AOH minus has to be equal to the nominal concentration of the hydroxide. And so I can write that this has to be equal to 0.02 molar. Now, so here, at this point, I have two possibilities. Remembering that the pH plus the pOH has to be equal to 14, and with the pOH equals to minus logarithm of the concentration of the hydroxide ions, and this is a possibility. In this case, you can write this logarithm minus logarithm of 0.02 equals to 1.7. We already calculated this value, and after you can derive subtracting in practice 14 by, you can derive the pH, of course, subtracting 14 by the pOH. That is a not used logarithm scale, but it's only a scale of a smart scale to use in this situation, avoiding to directly calculate the concentration of the hydronium starting from the hydroxide. And so you can write here 12.3. And of course, this pH is higher than 7, indicating a basic condition in this solution. We had dissolved a base, and so it is normal. But if I would calculate the concentration directly, the concentration of the hydronium ions starting from this concentration, I could remember that the ionic product of the water is equal to 10 elevated at to minus 14. And so we can calculate from this constant of equilibrium of the dissociation, of the ionic dissociation of water, that the concentration of the ion, of the hydronium ion, is equal to 10 to minus 14 divided by the concentration of the hydroxide ions. And also in this case, we can obtain a value, a very useful value, because 10 elevated to minus 14, no, I did a mistake, to minus 14 divided 0.02 equals to 5 multiplying 10 to minus 13. And if we to minus 13. Okay. So if we do the pH of this quantity, minus 13, we obtain that has to be equal to 12.3. Exactly the same. Okay? So, when we have strong acids and strong bases, it's very simple to arrive to calculate the pH of the solution in which they are dissolved. I think it's still simple. The calculation of the pH related to the weak acid and bases. Nothing so difficult to do. Calculate the calculate how much nitric acid in grams. Needs to be dissolved in 0.5 liters of water to obtain a solution with pH equals to 2. Okay. Okay, and then of course during the exam I will give you the formula of the species I'm asking you. Don't be worried. Here we have the nitric acid, and so the first thing I need to write the dissolution of the acid in water. Nitric acid is a strong acid. In the text of exercise has no any reference to equilibrium constant, so I'm sure that it is strong, and it gave rise to the hydronium ions and nitric and nitrate anions. Okay? So, if the pH has to be equal to 2, this means that minus logarithm of the concentration of the hydronium cation is equal to 2. And then the logarithm of the same cation equals to minus 2. So we can obtain the concentration of the hydronium cations to be equal to the base of the logarithm 10 elevated to the result of the logarithm. In this case, the pH changed of sign, minus 2 molar. That means moles on liters, moles per liters. So, but because this is a complete reaction, the reasoning in the reverse modality to the previous exercise, I can tell that the concentration of the nitric acid that have to be used to obtain this result in solution has to be equals exactly to the concentration of the hydronium cations, 10 elevated to minus 2 molar. So this means that I can calculate the moles of the nitric acid, knowing the volume of the solution. In fact, I can write that the moles of H, I can write here in a more comfortable condition. Are equals to the concentration of the acid multiplying the volume. Concentration of the acid is equal to 10 to minus 2 multiplying 0.5. So we can obtain we can obtain 0.005 moles of the acid, the molar mass of the acid is 48 plus 14.02 plus 1.02, and this gives maybe 0.2 multiplying 0.005, and this has to be 0.315 grams. So, if we're dissolving water, this little quantity of nitric acid, we obtain a solution in an half liter, of course. We obtain a solution with pH equals to 2. I can go on. Okay, calculate the pH of the following solutions. And we have 0.02 molar of HCOOH. This is formic acid. With Ka equals to 2.1 multiplying 10 to minus 4. Okay, here we have the first weak acid we are encountering today. And this is the formic acid, one of the smallest acid, organic acid we know. And so, the reaction of the solution of a weak acid, it's in practice follows the same mechanism of the strong acid, but the difference is that in this case we encounter an equilibrium condition. So there is the formation of the hydronium ions plus the formate ions remaining after the given of the acid molecules to the acid. You have to consider that the way to write the formula of the organic and inorganic acids is different. In the inorganic acids, as the ones we seen previously, hydrochloric, nitric, sulfuric, and so on, the protonable hydrogen is in front of the formula. When we consider the organic acid, the releasable hydrogen is at the end of the formula. So is this one, the H plus given to the from the acid to the water, and so the anions remaining is this one, formate ion. So doing that, what we can do? We can use the same reaction table used for the generical equilibrium to arrive to define what will be the equilibrium concentration of the hydronium acid, of the hydronium ions, to value that will permit us to calculate the pH. Okay, so we have the concentration of the acids. Here I have to put all the species that are able to have influence on the equilibrium. In this case, when we dissolve the acids, we obtain species in solution inside the water that is liquid. Okay, the liquid, the water liquid, has not to be placed here, has not to be placed inside the equilibrium constant, because the density of the liquid water is constant to a constant temperature. And so, this is in practice an heterogeneous equilibrium, in which here we have these molecules hydrated in water. Is here I'm writing AQ, that stands for aqueous. Aqueous means that all these substances, all these particles, ions, molecules, are surrounded by a sort of water shell, and this mechanism of dissolution of the water to the substances are called hydration. And okay, so here we have hydrated substances and the water that is liquid. So the water has not to be considered. Plus, okay, initial condition, variation, and equilibrium. Okay, so the initial concentration of the acid is equal to 0.02 molar. What is the initial concentration of the hydronium ion? Well, if you remember the lesson of Professor Panzini, you could say that in the pure water, without anything dissolved, the concentration of the hydronium cation is 10^-7. A very, very little concentration. This means that a poor number of the water molecules are really dissociated in water. This reasoning brings me to consider that I can avoid to consider the contribution of the water. It's too much small to the respect of this concentration of the acid. So here I can write zero, and zero also for these anions cation, ion. So the variation For the acids are very simple, the variation, because in most of the cases, the coefficients are all 1, 1, 1, 1. So I can tell that to the respect of an unknown quantity minus X of acid that undergoes the reaction actually, there must be a variation of plus X and plus X, remember the coefficient 1, 1, for these two elements. And so the equilibrium concentration will be 0.02 minus X, X, X. And so I can write at this point, at this time, the equilibrium, the acidic equilibrium constant of the formic acid, that is equal to concentration of the hydronium cation multiplied the concentration of the formate anion divided by the concentration of the formic acid. All the concentration are related to the equilibrium, of course. And but so substituting this what we obtained here, I obtain X multiplying X divided by 0.02 minus X equals to X quadratic X divided by 0.02 minus X equals to this value, 2.1 multiplying 10 to minus 4. Okay, so it seems that in a similar way to the previous exercise, we need to solve a second grade equation. But here I can do something smart to avoid this long and boring calculation. I can consider that the Ka is enough small to tell that this X has to be little, so little that I can consider it negligible in this calculation. So I can think that 0.02 minus this very little number is in practice equals to 0.02 with this X that tends to be near zero. Okay? His reasoning allows me to write that X 22.0 minus X in practice equals to X 22 divided by 0.02 equals to 2.1 multiplying 10 to minus 4. And so X is equals to radical of 2. Okay. On this term. So I bring in the second member the denominator here of the X, and then I realize the radicals in both the terms of the equation. equals. I hope I have calculated this quantity. No. I have obtained 0.00205. And so now I know that this is exactly the concentration of the hydronium ion. And so I can write concentration of H3 plus O equals to 0.00 molar. So pH has to be equal to minus logarithm of this quantity. 0.005 equals 2.7. Can do the last exercise. Evaluate the degree of dissociation of 1 molar. With 1 molar iodic acid. The iodic acid is HINOCNOHIO3. With KA equals to 1.6 multiplying 10 to minus 1. Okay. As any other acid, we go to write nitrogen. we go to write the reaction of dissociation of the acid inside the water. As always, you have to sum the water as a reactant, obtaining the dihydronium cation plus the anion derived from the acid, the molecule of the acid, this iodate anion. Okay, so, and we know also in this case the constant of equilibrium of this acid that is weak but becomes to be strong. So, this exercise could be solved in two ways, I think. The first is considering, as always, the table of reaction, initial variation and equilibrium. HeO3, H3O plus, EO, IO minus. Okay. We put here 1 because it's 1 molar, 0, 0 as said before, minus X plus X plus X, 1 minus X, X, X. The Ka is equal to concentration H3O plus, multiplying the concentration of the iodate anion, divided by concentration at the equilibrium of the acid, the molecule of the acid. This is equals to X to 2 divided by 1 minus X. This is equals to 0.16. So in this case, the K is too much big to reply the reasoning did in the previous exercise. So here we have to solve this second grade equation, but it's very fast and simple. Here we have quadratic X equals to plus 0.17 X minus 0. Okay? X equal minus 0.16. Okay, here I first do this calculation. 0. Okay. So, I can write directly the value 8.1 divided 2. So, 1 results is 2 could be 0.33. The other result is minus. So X has to be minus. Absurd.
I can avoid to consider and to calculate it.
So, can go back here.
Oh.
I have understood that the concentration of H3O plus has to be equals to 0.33 moles on volume, or molar as you want. And so the pH of 0.33 gives what gives logarithm 0.48. So a very, very acidic solution. But consider that the equilibrium constant of this acid begins to be enough big, and the molar concentration, the initial molar concentration is very high. One molar is not it's an high concentration, and so we can justify these results. The last thing I would like to let you see is the second possibility we have when we are talking about the I have to calculate the not the I was forgetting it. Here we have to calculate the degree of dissociation and not the pH. Okay, I calculate also the pH. It's not a problem. It's something more. So we can define the degree of dissociation, a parameter that we usually indicates with alpha, defined by the ratio between the moles of the acid reacted divided by the moles of the acid initial. In practice, the moles of the acid that have reacted actually are this one. This is the part of the initial quantity of the acid that undergoes a reaction actually. And so I have to consider this quantity, the X, to define what is the degree of dissociation to the respect of the initial number of the moles of the molecules of the acid. In practice, here I can write that alpha is equals to X divided the initial concentration of the acid. In this case, I can write the iodide acid equals to, in this case, 0.33 divided by the initial concentration, it's 1, 1. And so we obtain that alpha is equals to 0.33. But if I multiply by 100 this number, I obtain the percentage of dissociation of the molecules of the acid to the respect of the initial condition. In practice, I can write alpha equals to 0.33 multiplying 100 equals to 33%. So the 33% of the initial molecules of the acid present at the beginning of the dissolution are really dissociated. The last thing I would like to say you start using this relation. If alpha is equal to X, the quantity that has reacted actually, divided the initial concentration here, I'm indicating G is equals to a concentration between brackets. It's not a problem. I would like to see to write something more clear. So CE is the same of a concentration between the brackets. And so I can write X equals to alpha multiplying the initial concentration of the acid. So if I would know alpha, I can immediately calculate the hex, and so also the pH of the acid. So knowing alpha could be a very useful condition. And if we substitute these things in the equation of the Ka, X here, if you see, we have one that is the initial concentration of the acid. So generalizing without putting in numbers in particular, here we have a typical condition of the dissolution of an acid, of a weak acid. If we substitute this here, we can obtain alpha quadro multiplying the initial concentration to quadratic. Here, Ci minus alpha Ci. And so, okay, here we can put in evidence 1 minus alpha. And finally, we can obtain here, simplified, alpha to 2 multiplying the initial concentration of the acid divided 1 minus alpha is equal to the equilibrium constant of the acid. So here we have a relation between the K and alpha of any kind of acid. And this formula could be very useful to calculate the K, knowing the alpha, or differently, calculate the initial concentration knowing alpha and K, and so on. This formula is called Ostwald law. And could be used also in this exercise. If you want, you can practice using this formula to solve again this exercise. Okay, dear students. I thank you for your attention, and I hope we will see soon, and have a nice day. Bye.